From coast to coast and around the world, it's time to praise the Lord. Praise the Lord covers the major Christian events in America and across the world, from the heart of Europe. To the tip of Africa. From the centers of Asia. To Central and South America. Welcome to the number one Christian network in all the world. Joining us from Trinity Christian City International in Costa Mesa, California, for a special End Times Praise are founder of El Shaddai Ministries in Washington State, Mark Fields, author, speaker, and radio host, Phil Zellis, rabbi, senior pastor, and author, Jonathan Kahn, ministering in music, singer, songwriter, actor, speaker, and producer, Javen. Ready to take your calls, prayer partners around America. Founder and president of Voice of Evangelism Ministry, Harry Stone!
If you are even halfway as excited as this audience is, it's going to be crazy on TBN today. You know, I'm telling you, it's going to be fabulous. Now, I want to take a moment. My voice is a little weak because I've been in Orange County ministering, and we did 7 services in 3 days. I am a glutton for preaching the word, in case you didn't know it. Okay, I am addicted to the gospel. But today is going to be very special because we're going to do a very important, very significant prophetic evening for the TBN audience around the world. I don't know that there has ever been a time when so many things are happening at the same time. Everyone knows that Jesus talked about wars, rumors of wars, famines, pestilence, earthquakes in diverse places. And people have often said to me, Perry, these have been going on for centuries. Why do you even say it's the time of the end or the last days? This has been going on almost since the beginning of time. But Jesus gave us a statement in Luke, and Luke recorded it that said, when all these things began to come to pass. Now watch, when all these things. And so what it is, it's not just the fact that there's an earthquake and pestilence. And you know, the Greek word pestilence in Matthew 24 means the plague that ends in death, a plague that brings death about. It's not just that. It's when they all combine themselves to happen at one time. You see what's happening in the Middle East with ISIS. You see all the wars and rumors of wars taking place. You see plagues like Ebola that 25,000 people affected in Africa and over 9,000 have died, and it hasn't ended. These are the signs of the time of the end. But today, our guests are not just going to concentrate on Matthew 24. Jonathan Kahn has written a New York Times bestseller book called The Shemitah, and he's going to talk about that and the cycle that we're about to come into. Pastor Mark Biltz is a man who understands the cycles connected to cosmic signs. And Bill Salas is a man that is going to be talking about a prophecy of Elam, and that's a name of a place in the Bible, and how it relates to a nation that exists right now that is on the news every day. And so what we're going to do in a few moments is we're going to bring all those men to this platform. Now, instead of doing the normal interview at TBN, which many of you have seen us do, in which we talk to a person one-on-one for a period of time, we're going to have all the men on the set at the same time. And as the Spirit of God, amen, isn't that great? And as the Spirit of God begins to flow through us or anoint them, we're going to be bouncing off of each other the revelation and the illumination insight that the Holy Spirit has given us. Now, ladies and gentlemen, may I suggest to you, go to Facebook, Twitter, your telephone, whatever you have to do, and make a call right now and tell them what's about to happen. We also want to just make mention. Now, if my voice gets high, you're going to know that I've just about preached it out. But Pastor Willie Holmes and Pastor Vanessa Holmes are with us from Fullerton, California. Would you welcome them? Thank you so much for being with us. God bless you. Got some folks here. And I think what we'll do in preparation is we're going to go to Javen right now with a song called Lift Me Up. And we're going to get the men out here because I know you're as excited as I am to get started with this program today. Now, look, Javen has so many awards, so many albums, so many films he's been involved with. I couldn't even take time to read it. It would take 5 minutes. So instead of trying to read about what he does, let's hear what he does. Javen, come on, brother. Sing the house down. Lift me up.
Come on, let's give the Lord some praise tonight. Come on, jump up on your feet with me. Wherever you are around the world, get ready. It's time to praise the Lord. Amen. Somebody shout hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands with me, everybody. When I was down and helpless,
lifted me up.
I couldn't find my way. Lord, you're greater. Come on, clap your hands, everybody. So I will praise you louder. Tell of your goodness and power.
Make a joyful noise.
Yes, you are the world.
Me.
Here we go. Say up, up, up.
You lift me up.
You got it. Say
up, up, up. You lift me up.
You lifted me up.
Up, up, up. You lift me up.
Lifted me up.
Up, up, up.
Here we go. Say higher.
Higher.
Let's go higher tonight. Somebody scream for Jesus tonight. Thank you for giving me goodness. Saving me from destruction. I will worship you. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. So I'll praise you louder. Tell of your goodness and power. Yes, you are the world. All right, I need everybody to sing up with me. Say up, say up, 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 you lift me
up.
Come on, say
up, 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 you lift me up.
You lifted me up.
Up, 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 you lift me up.
Lifted me up.
Up, 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 you
lift me up. Here we go. Say
higher.
All my worshipers, say higher.
Higher.
Come on, lift your voice. Higher.
Higher.
Say higher.
Higher.
All right, repeat after me. Through the storm
and the rain,
every day
I will sing
of your love and your mercy and your grace. Come on, let's go higher. Oh, say up. Keep right on. Jesus, keep lifting me. Lifting me. Tonight. Come on, let's go higher. Say higher.
Higher.
Say higher.
Higher.
Ooh, say
higher.
You keep taking me
higher.
Higher, higher.
Higher.
Anybody wanna go
higher?
Let's go higher.
Higher.
Let's go higher. Somebody make some noise for Jesus in the house tonight. Lift me higher. Somebody scream. Come on, clap those hands. Wherever you are today, just begin to lift up the name of Jesus. And you'll find things turning around. Say higher.
Higher.
Anybody want to?
Higher.
Anybody want some praise. Let's make some noise. Say, you lift me up. Somebody give him glory in the house tonight. Come on, bless his name. Hallelujah.
If you've just tuned in, welcome to TBN, a special prophecy evening with three speakers. Actually, if I count myself, I guess that's four. What are we, the four men in the fiery furnace? I don't know. But we're about to have a great move of God as we talk about end time prophecy. I'm going to begin on my left or on the screen. Well, you know what matter on the screen? It'll be a close-up, come to think of it. We're going to talk with Bill Salas, who is from La Quinta, California, founder of Prophecy Depot Ministries, an author of numerous books, and also a radio host. Would you welcome him to TBN? Bill. Amen. And then the gentleman, which is again to my left, is Pastor Mark Biltz from, that's Bonnie Lake, Washington, founder of El Shaddai Ministries in Washington State. He is also a well-known author, a researcher, and is just becoming very noted on some of the teaching God has given him recently. Would you welcome Pastor Mark with us tonight to TBN? Amen. Then the gentleman on my right is really no stranger to anyone in the United States, especially after he wrote the New York Times best-selling book that stayed on the New York Times number one list for months, not weeks, but months, called The Harbinger, and recently came up with a new book called The Shemitah, and it is none other than Rabbi Jonathan Kahn from New Jersey. Would you welcome him to TBN? Now, gentlemen, as we're talking off camera, each of you has a certain area of specialty that God's put in your heart. And what I want to do is take about 2 minutes each and say, and just give the audience the thing that is burning in your heart right now the most, and then we're going to come back and we'll start our discussion. Jonathan, what is it that you're feeling right now?
I believe we are at a critical time, a critical juncture, really. Things are converging in a tremendous way. One of the things is with the Harbinger is that since the book came out, they have not stopped. They've continued to manifest. In fact, some, we will get into while I was with you, things are happening with that. The other thing is that the convergence is this thing called the Shemitah, which is this biblical cycle of God that God gives that actually gives the timing of judgment, the timing of warning, and this mystery, we call the Shemitah, most people don't know what it is, but it is the seventh year of the Hebrew calendar. And that is behind everything from the rise and fall of the economy, the collapse of Wall Street, the rise and fall of nations, end time prophecy, what people don't realize. Even something that links to the restoration of Israel, what happened in the Jerusalem, and what may be happening very soon. All these things are converging. And we are right now in a Shemitah year. And so we are not setting dates and we're not saying God has to do anything, but we do need to know the signs of the times. There are already signs that are beginning to happen concerning. We're even witnessing a kind of unraveling. The same period of time, we're watching America rapidly accelerate from God, rapidly. And at the same time, we're also watching America distance itself from Israel. So all these things are danger signs. And so the thing is that I believe, you know, one of the things, the reason I didn't plan on writing any of it, but I believe that God wants the trumpet to be sounded. We need to be ready, and the people of God need to be ready. Before God judges, he warns. Yes. So we are in a critical period, and we need to be ready.
Thank you for that introduction. Now, Mark, what's the keynote thing at this moment that you feel like the Holy Spirit's giving you to give to the body? Now, we're going to come back to all of this in a moment, guys. This is just the foundational part. What would you say?
Well, I would say that God wants to bring understanding to his people in these last days, kind of like the sons of Issachar that understood the times. And I believe we need to know this. Genesis 1:14, God said he created the sun and the moon to send signals on the Moedim, on the feast days, like Passover, like tabernacles. And then to see these things happening, March 20th, a total solar eclipse, Nisan 1, you know, and then we have a total blood moon on April 4th. And so we need to realize that we are on God's calendar. I think that's the most important thing, that the church realizes there's a calendar. God has a day timer. And end time events are all based on that calendar, which ties right into what Jonathan's saying about the Shemitah year. We have to understand the times and the seasons.
Bill, what's the primary thing that's on your heart right now for the nation or the world?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'm so convinced that we're in the end times, deep into the end times. And as you've been talking about, Jonathan's been talking about, the number one sign that we're in the end times is that all the signs are converging. Bible prophecy is about a third of the Bible, and it's very important at this point that we understand that God intended a lot of that prophecy for this generation. My concern is, what are the prophecies that are about to happen? What is imminent? Been on the had an opportunity many occasions, especially this year, to be with this group of fine teachers here. And I don't see that as a coincidence. You know what they say, coincidence is God's way of remaining anonymous. What your viewers are going to hear tonight is some real important sense of urgency with the Shemitah, with the blood moons and that sort of thing. And we might actually see the fulfillment, the literal fulfillment of a Bible prophecy and maybe prophecies, Barry, in this year or in the very near future. And so that's my concern, is what could be coming? What are these guys warning about? What could the literal prophecies be that we might need to be concerned about?
Okay, I'm going to play the advocate for just a few minutes. Jonathan, your biggest critics of the Harbinger, for example, are saying he's taking Old Testament verses applying to Israel and trying to make them fit America. Mm-hmm. You're a rabbi. Now, look, I understand Hebraic thought and rabbinical thought, okay? So I can explain this. About two-minute explanation. Why do you do it? Mm-hmm. How does it work? Mm-hmm.
Well, first off, if we stop applying the things of Israel to us, we got to cut down all churches and all preaching, because God said he gave these for examples for us. So God's the same God. The God of Israel is the God of the nations. He's God of the world. Secondly, he's consistent when he warns, and he has patterns and he has templates of how he does it. Beyond that, the fact is, I wasn't trying to connect anything. It's happening. I mean, you know, I didn't look for this. I was standing at ground zero, and I see this object, and something says you have to there's something there you got to find. It turns into this mystery that keeps unfolding and unfolding and unfolding, and you have leaders, you have American leaders voicing these prophetic judgments on America. They don't know what they're doing, you know, but it's all lining up exactly. So the ultimate thing is that it's the same God yesterday, today, and forever. He is the God of all nations, and he is affecting all nations. The God of Israel is the God of prophecy, and so he is going to do that. So it's not a matter of trying to put it together. Right. He's putting it together.
Don't you think Ecclesiastes 1, the thing which has been is that which shall be.
Yes.
And that which has been done is that which shall be done. Nothing new. It cycles. Does it not cycle?
Yes.
Now, speaking of cycles, blood moons, Joel 2, Acts 2, are actually rabbinically full lunar eclipses. Now, Mark, your critics would say there's always been lunar eclipses. There's always been solar eclipses. So why would Pastor Biltz get so excited about the cycles that we're in? So in about 2 to 3 minutes, how would you answer your critic?
According to NASA, over the last 5,000 years, there's been 12,000 total lunar eclipses. Total lunar eclipses. Of those, only 4,000 have been total lunar eclipses. And that means you only average one total lunar eclipse every year and a half. And if you only average one total lunar eclipse every year and a half, and here we have four in a row in a year and a half, and they're all landing on the feast days, this is definitely a mathematical anomaly. And then when you go back and do the research, and you find out that it happened in 32, 33 AD when Yeshua died, right around there, it happened around 70 AD at the destruction of the temple. You see this thing's happening right after they became a nation in 1948, 1967, they recaptured Jerusalem. Like you said, God uses patterns, and these are being seen all around the world.
Now, I would also add, I'm gonna do the little verses here, okay? I would also add, Jesus tells us to look for signs in the sun, moon, and stars. He told us.
Yes.
So he knew something would be evident in the sun and in the moon, asteroids, comets, whatever you want to call them. So that's why you're excited about this, isn't it?
Well, I mean, Genesis 1:14, God said there will be signs in the suns and the moons. Luke 21:25, Jesus says, guess what, guys? There will be signs in the sun and the moon.
Right.
So I believe what Jesus says.
Now, Bill, you have done some research, and we'll get into this later, of taking the names from the Old Testament that are not used today. In other words, these are names like Elam is a name. We don't hear about that, but you've discovered that those ancient names are modern-day nations, and the prophecies from those names have not yet happened in many instances. So is that, and I know you and I, we all believe it is, but for those of you who would not accept that, how would you answer a critic that would come to you and say, well, I don't know, I think that has been, that's Ezekiel 38 and 39, some people say, has already happened. Totally impossible, we know that. But when you deal with this subject and you have people that encounter you, and to counter it, Give us a little answer of how you counter some of your and I think this is good because people watching, this could help them.
Well, absolutely, and that's a very important point. You know, there's approximately 31,173 verses in the Bible, and about 9,000 to 10,000 of those are devoted toward Bible prophecy. Now, many of those have already found fulfillment, and as we study Bible prophecy, we have to be very scrutinous about, has something we're studying already found a historical fulfillment? You've really got to be careful about that because you don't want to make something that you think is about to happen that has already happened. So you've got to look at that very closely. And then you look at, well, is it intended for right now? Is it imminent? Or is it perhaps going to be in Daniel's 70th week, the tribulation period? You have to compartmentalize that type of thing by the clues and details you're given within the prophecy. When we talk about Elam, for instance, Elam goes back to Genesis 14, the time of Abraham. You know, he was the son of Shem, the grandson of Noah. And he's listed several different places in the Bible. But in 596 B.C., Jeremiah writes about Elam in a prophecy that I believe is for our time. And it turns out to be dealing with the modern-day state of Iran.
Wow. And we're going to deal with that later. Let me ask you this also. Don't you think there are some verses that have double application? And one of the examples, let me give this, and we'll go back to Jonathan. One of the verses is when Jesus went to Egypt, Mary, Joseph, and Jesus went. The writer said, as the prophet has said, out of Egypt I've called my son. Well, if you go to Hosea and read the verse, it says, I have called my son Israel out of Egypt. Mm-hmm. And it's really dealing with Israel. Hosea is, he's not dealing with Jesus. And that the gospel writer says it's Jesus. Mm-hmm. But then when you understand that Israel, through Sarah, was a supernatural birth, and through Mary, Jesus was a supernatural birth, Israel is called the son of God in Exodus. Jesus is called the son of God. You can apply those verses. And so I think that a lot of times, Bill, when we're studying the Word of God and we're studying prophecy, we will see a verse that maybe has had its primary fulfillment, but it repeats itself in history. God pouring out His Spirit on the day of Pentecost and the last days is a good example. Mm-hmm. It happens twice. So, Jonathan, let's go to you. Now, we've got a little time here. I want to take you to take us to the Shemitah, which is a book you've written, mm-hmm. and explain to the audience a little bit about this. We're going to give mm-hmm. you some time here to yes. share. The people want to hear this.
Yeah, the mystery of the Shemitah begins on Mount Sinai when Moses, through God, gives it to him to ordain every seventh year as the Sabbath year. Everybody knows the seventh day is the Sabbath day, but the seventh year was the Sabbath day. Actually, year, there was no reaping, no sowing the land. Everything rests until the last day, which is called Elul 29. On that day, all debts are wiped out, all credits wiped out, everything's wiped out. And now it's a blessing. But when Israel turned away from God, this blessing of the Shemitah becomes a judgment upon them. When they were taken into Babylon, the prophet said it was because they were there for 70 years because the land had a rest for the Shemitahs right. that they broke. So it becomes a sign that actually, notice even in that, that determines the rise of Babylon, the fall of Babylon, the rise of Persia, all according to the Shemitah. So the question is, or the big thing is that what God has ordained, what God set up, could this still be in effect? Just like he uses the seven-day week, could he use this, and could it be a sign of judgment at key times? And the answer is yes. What the mystery of the Shemitah is revealing is that this has affected all of our lives from the moment we were born. It affects end-time prophecy. It affects our bank accounts. It affects everything. Example, just with the financial and economic realm. The last 40 years, there have been five major financial long-term collapses. The years are 1973, 1980, 87, 2000, and 2007. Now, something about those years, every single one of them takes place on a seven-year cycle to the one before, the one after. Secondly, do any of these things take place on the actual Shemitah appointed by God?
Which is the seventh year.
The seventh year. And so here's it. 1973 collapse, year of the Shemitah. 1980 collapse, year of the Shemitah. 1987 collapse, year of the Shemitah. 2000, year of the Shemitah. 2007, year of the Shemitah. And in the middle, you have 1994, which is the greatest bond market collapse in history. So every single time. And Barry, if you expand this, let's go not just 40 years, but modern history, top three crashes ever. Number three is 1937, 1938, second part of the Great Depression. 1937 to 38 is the year of the Shemitah. Number two is 2007 to 2008, the Great Recession. 2007 and 8 is the year of the Shemitah. Number one, 1930-31, Great Depression. 1930 and 31 is the year of the Shemitah. 1937, the Shemitah begins. Next day, Wall Street collapses. 1931, the Shemitah makes the ultimate, that wipeout day, that Elul 29, mm-hmm. that ushers in the worst month in stock market history. Now, here's another thing. Let's see, does it even pinpoints it to the time of year? Because stock market crashes can happen any time of the year, a day right. crash, any time. Right. But in the Bible, the particular time is the month of Tishri. You know it. And Tishri, when it comes at the end of the seven-year cycle, it comes right after that Elul 29 wipeout, becomes the month of the wipeout. So the question is, of all the greatest day crashes in history, do any of them happen at the time of Tishri? The answer is the majority of them do.
Oh, come on.
The majority. In
wow.
fact, it gets even more than that. The majority, they can happen any time of the year. They happen all the majority cluster around a 2.5-week period of the Hebrew year. Only, imagine, it can happen any time of the year. Happen at that time. Here's another thing. If you look at do any of the greatest point crashes happen near that Elul 29 wipeout at the end of the Shemitah? The top five, every single one of them happens at the end of the year of the Shemitah. Top five. And the overlap to the day of wipeout, Elul 29, is between 99 and 100%. And the thing is, Perry, it's getting more intense.
So now tell the audience on Tishrei, what month is that on our
yeah,
month?
Perfect
thing. What time of the year is it?
Yeah, let me put it this way. For years, financial analysts said, why are all these crashes? They tend to take place at one time of the year, autumn, October, Black Monday, all that stuff. Yeah. Well, it's September, October. Well, September, October is Tishrei. They could never explain it, but God can explain it. And what they're saying is that God is in charge of every detail, everything in the world. Yeah. He is over it. You know, and it's getting more intense.
Now let me say this. We have a roll-in. Do you want to go to your roll-in?
Yeah, if we can do it, sure.
Okay, I'll set this up. Jonathan's going to set this up. It's a three-minute roll-in, but he's going to share this.
I'll set this up. Well, here it is. One of the things, of the alarming things of judgment, is that this phenomenon is getting it more intense, is getting stronger. And so you have 2001, you have 9/11, and then 9/11 causes the greatest point crash in American history to this day, on September 17, 2001. Well, what day is that? That day was Elul 29, the day of the Shemitah that God appointed only once in 7 years on the exact day to wipe out financial accounts. That's 2001. Now, that alone is enough, but that lasts for record for 7 years until the next Shemitah comes around. And I believe the clip will show you'll see it actually happen. Okay.
The greatest stock market collapse in world history takes place on the 29th day of Elul, the exact day appointed from ancient times for the nullifying of the financial realm, the wiping out of financial accounts. Elul 29, the day of the Shemitah, the sign of judgment against a nation that has driven God out of its life. The judgment that specifically strikes the nation's economic and financial realm. The two greatest collapses in stock market history up to those dates, each took place on the same exact day on the ancient biblical calendar. And they just happened to each take place on the precise biblical day that's specifically ordained to touch the nation's financial realm and to wipe clean its financial accounts from ancient times, the day of financial nullifying. And it's not only Elul 29, but it can only be one Elul 29 in 7 years that can constitute the day of the Shemitah, the day of nullification. So on which Elul 29 did the greatest stock market collapse take place in the year 2008? It happened on the once in 7 years Elul 29, the exact one that constitutes the day of the Shemitah. And the greatest crash of 2001, when did it take place? It happened on the once in 7 years Elul 29 that also constituted the Bible's day of the Shemitah. So when all across the world, observant Jews are symbolically canceling out their debts to each other, the greatest wiping out of financial accounts in history is taking place on Wall Street and sweeping across the globe. According to the ancient mystery, the financial nullification has to take place 7 years apart from the one before or after. So the two greatest financial nullifications in Wall Street history up to their dates take place 7 years apart. Not only on Elul 29, but 7 years apart, seven exact biblical years apart, down to the exact season, the exact month, the exact date, the exact hour, the exact minute, the exact second, the exact closing bell. No human hand in the world could have orchestrated such a thing. It required the working together of every financial transaction and interaction in the world. It even required that 9/11 had to have happened exactly when it did, as it was 9/11 that caused Wall Street to collapse in 2001 on the exact ancient appointed day.
Wow. Now, Jonathan, I don't want to jump ahead of you. I want you to stay in this flow in this session here. Mm-hmm. My mathematics tells me 2015 is your Shemitah year. Is that right?
Yep. You are correct, sir.
And if the cycles have been so precise, mm-hmm. are we going to go into a fall cycle, perhaps, mm-hmm. that mm-hmm. we're going to see something globally, you think?
Well, this is what we'll get into. Won't jump ahead. We will touch on it. I believe that's one of the reasons of writing the book, and that's one of the reasons of talking about this now. We're not saying God's in a box, he doesn't have to do anything, but I do believe a very great shaking is coming to America and to the world. But America, it will involve the financial realm, the economic realm, and be more than that. And it could happen at this time. Now, there are patterns of when these things happen. And the thing is, you know, the Shemitah's begun. We're still at the first section. We're approaching the middle. But even when it began, because the last time it happened, there were foreshadows at the beginning of what was going to happen at the end. Well, I believe there have been foreshadows. And actually, there's an amazing one. Before we're off, I'll show it to you. But that there are signs that this could be very significant. So everything's converging right now. I mean, we are in the year right now when America will redefine marriage, most likely. We're watching a great apostasy. We're watching relations with Israel break down. We're watching the world order break down. You know, one of the Shemitah in Hebrew can mean the release, but it can also mean the fall or the collapse or the shaking. And this is, you know, it was in 9/11, that happened at the very peak of the Shemitah when 9/11 happened. I mean, all this. So I believe we need to be ready, because we have not gotten closer to God since 9/11, this nation. Yeah. This nation has grown farther from God. Mm-hmm. So I believe anybody who knows the signs of the times or has the Spirit in them knows that something's coming. Yeah. And so now we got all these things converging. So yes, we'll talk about exact things. There have been exact, fascinating biblical signs that have already appeared this year.
Wow. Now, I will be going into a song in about 4 minutes to Jabin. We want him to get ready and give us a little bit of break, some time to get some water, because I'm telling you, we're going to need it tonight, aren't we, guys? And we're going to go in a moment to Mark, who's going to tie in the cycle of blood moons with the Shemitah. Mm-hmm. Folks, listen to me. You need to get a hold of somebody right now and call them or contact them and say, turn TBN on. This is going to be one of the most interesting prophetic programs you have ever heard in the past several years. Now, I want to go back to something again so people understand. Mm-hmm. We're using a Hebrew word, Shemitah.
Yes.
So here's what God establishes. God establishes every seventh day, Shabbat or Sabbath.
Yes.
God established every seventh year, the Shemitah year, in which the land was supposed to rest.
Yes.
And you were supposed to just chill out, release. You know, it was a freedom time.
It was release, yeah.
Then 7 times 7 is 49. Now, I know you got something on this, too.
Yeah.
And we may have to come back after we get with other guys, and we'll come back to you on this.
Yes.
But 7
yes.
times 7, 49 yes. is Jubilee,
yes.
the Yovel, the Jubilee cycle. Mm-hmm. And even the Jubilee cycles of 7 times 7 or 49 years are tying in with this, right?
Yes, totally. There's something I put at the end, but called the mystery of the seventh Shemitah. And the Jubilee is really a super Shemitah. People don't realize that. You cannot have the Jubilee without the Shemitah. But the thing is, the Jubilee had this amazing thing about restoration. So could this mystery actually give us the timing, the exact timing parameters of end time events, restoration of Israel, restoration prophetically, and what is this cycle is coming to a head very soon.
Now I want to clarify something here, which is good. You notice that Jesus said, no man knows the day or the hour of his coming. He's not talking about the coming. He's talking about cycles. God said to Noah, yet 7 days I'll cause it to rain. God said to Israel, 70 years in Babylonian captivity. Mm-hmm. I could go through the Bible and show you 7 times, at least, where God gave them a year where something was going to happen, a time frame or a warning. Nineveh had a time frame, 40 days, right? So when Jonathan is talking about, please keep in mind, he's not predicting the rapture, the return of the Lord, second coming, or whatever you'd like to call it. He's getting into cycles. God absolutely, one of the greatest studies I ever did as from the Hebraic side was understanding if you can tap into the cycles of God, you can tap into the timing of God.
Yes.
And what he's showing you here, and I want to make this clear, and I always like to, this is my little part of the program, is to kind of tie it together, is the cycles of seven, every seventh day Sabbath, every seventh year Shemitah, every seven times seven comes to the Jubilee, and all of these were supposed to be seasons of rest. However, when you disobeyed God, Israel did not keep the Shemitah. They didn't keep it. Guess what happened? 70 years Babylonian captivity. 10 commandments that they broke, right? They broke 10. God said in Leviticus, I'll punish you 7 times. 10 times 7 is 70. And the reason, read it in Chronicles, that they went into captivity, they did not keep the Shemitah. So America is patterned after Israel, and because we're not obeying God's word, and our nation was founded on the Torah. I'm talking about our documents. The Torah, the Psalms, and the Gospels. President Harry Truman made that statement publicly years ago. And if we don't follow the God that we are in covenant with our ancestors, you know, you that watch TV and Bill Cloud and I wrote a book, you'll see it on Manifest, about breaking God's covenant. And so we are breaking the covenant, and this is why it's so serious. Other nations can do what they want and get by with it. We can't, because we are responsible for knowing the Word of God and not being ignorant of it. Amen? And that's why these cycles are working. Now, here's what we're going to do. I want Jonathan, listen, we're not going to give you everything. You got to watch the whole program tonight. Okay. We're going to wait and come back to him in a moment. And then Mark's going to pick it up in just a second. And he's going to be sharing with us the blood moon cycles. Now, you may have heard this already, but he's got some other things he's going to share. He's going to tie it into Jonathan. And then Bill's going to come back and blow you away in the Word of God with how it all fits together as well. Now, Javen is coming. We're going to take a little breather here. Stay with us. Call somebody to watch TBN. Right now, praise. Come on, Javen, and sing the house down, brother.
Come on, clap your hands, everybody. If you love Jesus, say hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands with me like this. Here I stand before you, ready to give you all I can give. I surrender my life to you, open up my heart for you, I live.
For you I live.
'Cause Lord, you've done so much for me I can't describe. Your love has rescued my heart. This is your holy power. And I'm giving you right now praise, praise, praise. 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 Somebody make some noise. To you all the praise that's due. Your grace connects us to the wonders of your love. We lift our hands to you today. Release your holy power. And I'm giving you right now praise. From you, the winds and the waves are made calm. Yes, they are. And we worship all day long, 'cause you turned our sorrow into dancing. And I'm giving you right now praise, praise, praise. Come on, right now praise, praise. The Bible says, let everything that has breath, we ought to praise the Lord. That the more you praise Him, that's the more you'll sense His presence. And God will begin to bless you and heal you and deliver you. Come on, lift your voice. Right now, praise, praise, praise. Give you right now praise, praise, praise. Let's do it
this
now.
This is the day of the Lord.
Hey, I will rejoice and give you praise. This is the day the Lord has made. Yes, it is, yes, it is. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and give you praise. This is the day the Lord has made. Yes, it is, yeah, yeah. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and give you praise. This is the day the Lord has made. One more time, give the Lord a shout of praise in the house tonight. Hallelujah.
It's a great day here at TBN with our special guests that are here. This is a prophetic special that's going to be aired around the world. We're glad you're watching right now. We hope you're contacting, bringing your family around the television set or the computer, whatever you may be watching, as we continue our study. Now, Jonathan Kahn has shared with us about the Shemitah cycle. God is a God that works in cycles. The things that have been will be, and they will repeat themselves. Now, Mark, several years ago, you began to do some study on cosmic signs. I want you to pick up and bounce off a little bit of what Jonathan has said and tie in what's happening now, this year, on the Shemitah year, and just go with what you feel.
Well, thank you so much, Perry, and I'm so thankful to TBN, too, having us on. I think this is a wonderful time. One of the things I want to preface, before I go there, is, as many of you know, I want to jump in on the tie-in of Israel to the United States. And as you know, today, when it comes to the economy, everyone worships the stock market bull. You think of the big bull in New York. What a lot of people don't realize is the United States, July 4th, 1776, on the biblical calendar, was the 17th of Tammuz, the day Israel worshiped the golden calf. And so you see this tie-in with the bull and the economic worship. Well, in 1994, which was a Shemitah year. I don't know how many of you remember Shoemaker-Levy Comet. This was huge. It's a signs in the heaven. There were 21 fragments that pummeled Jupiter. Guess what day that happened on? It was the 9th of Av. Tisha B'Av is when there were 21 fragments hitting Jupiter in 1994. Well, there's seven Shemitah cycle. Seven times three is 21. I think God was trying to say that the next three Shemitah years were going to be times of judgment. So like Jonathan said, 2001, Elul 29 was the first strike. 2008, Elul 29, the second strike. We're coming into the third strike. And so I see it growing in intensity, what is coming. And so I see that happening, this 2015. But going back now to what you were saying, only eight times in 2,000 years have you had these four blood moons in a row. Okay, this will be the ninth time. And this is the first time in history, last 2,000 years, that it's happening in a Shemitah year, in the Shemitah cycle. And you have a super blood moon. Okay, it's not just a normal blood moon. The super blood moon, here is Earth, and the moon cycle is elliptical. So sometimes it's close, sometimes it's far away as it goes around. When the moon is at its closest point to Earth, if it's a full moon, it's known as a super moon. So here you're going to have a super blood moon during the Feast of Tabernacles, which is known as the Feast of Nations and judgment coming on the nations. First time in history you're going to have a super blood moon during the Feast of Tabernacles in a Shemitah cycle when the king of Israel is supposed to read to the Torah and every man, woman, and child has to be there. Now, one last thing that I want to bring out concerning the cycles that is mind-blowing when you get it. So I really want everyone to just stop and really get this. Daniel, y'all know the prophet Daniel. How many of you know he was Jewish? Okay. And as Jonathan said, it's because they did not keep that seven-year cycle that they went into judgment, right? So if that's being the case, everyone prophetically knows there's supposed to be 1 week left, which is 7 years or a 7-week cycle, which we call the tribulation.
That means it is a Shemitah cycle, a Shemitah unit, which means the first year of the tribulation cannot begin any year randomly. The first year of the tribulation has to begin in the first year of a Shemitah cycle. This fall begins the first year of a Shemitah cycle. Now, I'm not saying the tribulation is going to begin this fall, but when you understand the cycles, if it doesn't begin this fall, and it may not, perhaps it'll be 7 years later, or perhaps 7 years later. But the first year of the tribulation cannot start randomly anywhere in the cycle. The first year of the tribulation will be the first year of a Shemitah cycle.
Yeah, and what I want to add to this, just, and I want to go back and kind of put this out. Why is the significance placed on the moon with Israel? And it's because, and you want to answer that? Because they're on a lunar cycle. Their calendar is lunar, solar, not just solar, right?
Right. And they say that.
Explain that, why the moon is so important. You're talking about blood moon is considered a full lunar eclipse.
Yes, it is.
And that's, and Joel 2, we didn't lay a foundation in Joel 2 and Acts 2. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord. Rabbinically, it's lunar cycles. Lunar eclipses.
The months are lunar. Okay, and that's very important to understand. But like we add one day every 4 years to keep it with the solar cycle, they add an entire month, 7 times over 19 years. So it's a kind of a lunar solar. Now the Jews teach a total solar eclipse is judgment on the nations because the sun is so much bigger than the moon and there's more people. A total lunar eclipse is judgment coming upon Israel. Now it so happens that in 2015, we have a total solar eclipse March 20th, which is the first day of Nisan, the beginning of the religious calendar. That was the same day of the grand opening ceremony of Moses' tabernacle. That's when the fire fell from heaven and lit the altar. That's when the fire fell from heaven and killed Nadab and Abihu. And so here we have a total solar eclipse coming on March 20th, followed 2 weeks later by a total blood moon on Passover, followed by a solar eclipse on Rosh Hashanah, followed by another total lunar eclipse on Sukkot.
And can we add this, that it's not the fact that it's a lunar eclipse because they've happened, like you said, through history. It is when they fall on Jewish festivals, and when solar eclipses fall on the same Jewish festival, and when they happen on back-to-back years. And this is the significance, because we could say, well, you know, there was a lunar eclipse. Oh, it's a sign from the heaven. Well, it may be and may not be, except when, and what's happened, in case you're not familiar with this, sometimes I think we assume people have already heard the teaching, but a lot have not, is that on the first day of Passover and the first day of Tabernacles last year, first day of Passover and Tabernacles this year, there's blood moons. And Joel said the sun will be turned to darkness, the moon to blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. And so the interesting thing about this is that Israel's ancient calendar was solar lunar or a lunar calendar.
Yeah.
And to keep the feast days from falling, getting off kilter because it's a shorter calendar, 54, 55 days a year versus 365, your feast is going to get crazy. You're going to have your Passover in May, you know?
Right.
So they would add an extra month, 13th months versus 12 every so many years to keep it balanced. Now, this is why he is sharing with you that these are falling on the Shemitah years. This is a double significance. You got it? So in other words, it's not just the fact that blood moons are coming on festival days. Jonathan, they're coming on the Shemitah cycle. That's where it's really interesting to me. I think we'd all agree with that.
And there's a link here, too, because when the sun will be darkened in this Shemitah year, it'll be two times, basically. One is, as you said, in the spring, coming up soon. Interesting, because that day is also going to mark the exact center point day of the Shemitah. That is the central day. And then there'll be one more that's going to come on Elul 29, the wipeout day. On the wipeout day, on the solar eclipse.
Y'all catching this? This is getting really deep right now. I don't know if you got it or not. You're home. Right. You need to catch this.
That's right.
He was talking about Elul the 29th. Now, this is...
Elul 29 is...
Now, my arm, my hair just stood up when you said that.
That's right.
I got bumps on my arm. Read it. It might be real. God might be sending us a message. You know, that's what I tell my young people when it happens to me. Go ahead, John.
So here we have Elul 29, the day of the wipeout. On that day, the sun will be darkened.
Oh, boy.
And the thing is that... So now, the last time the sun was darkened on Elul 29... was 1987, which led into Black Monday, the worst day crash in history. It happened again during the Great Depression, right at that time, and again the same thing. So again, not that it has to, but it's, again, everything is converging.
Okay, can I ask you this? When will this cycle happen again, where it's back-to-back years on Passover and Tabernacles? I mean, is this going to happen three years from now?
Right.
When is it going to happen again? This is significant.
About 500 more years from now.
Yeah.
And I think what's so fascinating, and I believe you've mentioned this before, is that the Rosh Hashanah, Elul 29, is on a weekend. The markets are closed. And so the last day of the market's 9/11.
Yeah. In other words, as people know it, there's two things about it. And again, the first thing is, again, and we're saying this a lot because we're not saying God has to do anything, but you need to be aware of it and be ready. But the one thing is that it's going to happen on a Sunday. That's when this happens. So this Elul 29. So that can mean a few things. One is it can mean that also that the event that happens is bigger and greater than a financial collapse. And I'm like, 9/11 was actually what caused the other one. At the same time, the markets actually open, the Globex opens at 6 o'clock that night. So it's going to be that time. And then the other thing is that, as you said as well, the last day that it's open will be the 14th anniversary of 9/11. That's two Shemitah periods from the 9/11.
Exactly. Now, is this interesting to anybody in the audience? Come on, somebody. Isn't this great? And folks at home, look, stay with us. I know on the East Coast, TBN kind of has to go late on the East Coast time, but please stay with us. Now, let's go to Bill. Now, Bill, you guys have been teaching some together in some conferences lately. How does what you see or the possibility of what you see tie in to blood moon cycles on festival days and eclipses on specific Jewish days with what Jonathan's saying? How do you tie in? Do you believe that we're into something right now?
Well, I do, and it's always neat when I get to go on conferences and TV shows with these two, and I've been on quite a few of them, and I usually get to bat cleanup because they get everybody sitting right at the edge of their chair. There's going to be a shaking. 2015, the Shemitah's coming up. The dates, I believe, on the next blood moon is April 4th.
Yes.
That's coming right, you know, this year soon. That's my wife's birthday. That's how I remember that one. We've got the one on Tabernacles is coming on September 28th of 2015, I believe. So we're talking about a very important year, like I said in the intro, where you could have the literal fulfillment of a Bible prophecy. But what could it be that causes the shaking, that causes the types of things to collapse in our country and elsewhere in the world? And so I look specifically at ancient Bible prophecies that I believe are imminent. As we study Bible prophecy, it's important to take a look at all prophecies. You know, there's the Antichrist, and there's the tribulation, and a harlot world religion, and things like that. But as I got into prophecy, my main concern is what's going to happen now and in my family's future and that sort of thing. What is imminent? You know, there's a prophecy in Isaiah 17 that talks about there'll be a destruction of Damascus. Yeah. And it says Damascus will cease from being a city. It'll be a ruinous heap. That has not found fulfillment yet. Some people say that happened in 732 BC with the Assyrian Empire, but I say, look, Isaiah spoke in the 66 chapters 37 times about Assyria, and he never once mentions them in Isaiah 17. However, in verse 9 of Isaiah 17, he talks about there'll be desolation because of the children of Israel. Mm-hmm. Means there has to be an Israel. Verse 14, it talks about, at eventide you see Damascus, but in the morning he is no more. Speaking of Damascus and the masculine pronoun.
Can I say
pronoun.
This? The Assyrians could have never destroyed them in that 6 to 12-hour time frame.
Right.
Not in their day.
Right.
It would have taken days and days to destroy them, right?
Right.
Is that right?
Absolutely.
So this is a future prophecy is what you're saying.
Absolutely. Never found historical fulfillment, and it is primed. There is an Israel now, and there's a technology that one night you'll see Damascus, and in the morning it won't be there.
That's
the concern. I'm looking for that, but Psalm 83, I've been on the show many times with Jonathan. We've talked about that concluding Arab-Israeli war that talks about they'll come together in a confederacy to cut the nation of Israel off, that the name of Israel will be remembered no more. It predicated that there had to be an Israel. We have an Israel.
Can I ask you this? I don't want to interrupt you, but while it's on my mind, ISIS is in Syria, okay? Do you think it's possible? Now, this is just a scenario that something ISIS does could lead to the destruction of Damascus.
I think it is, and I'm going to get to that because I think something's going to happen that leads to ISIS getting even expanding further. I will say I think ISIS could be part of Psalm 83 if they go unchecked. Currently, the swaths of territory that ISIS has come under control is in ancient Assyria at the time the psalm was written in northern Syria and northern Iraq. And it's very specific in Psalm 83, verse 8. It says that Assyria will join with the children of Lot and will help them. And we're dealing with, that's Jordan, Moab and Ammon. They were the children of Lot. And Jordan is the, probably the next target on ISIS's agenda. But I think what I'm watching for most of all right now is a vastly overlooked prophecy. I've written a book on it called Nuclear Showdown in Iran. It's come out. It's revealing that ancient prophecy of Elam that you spoke about. And this prophecy, it's six verses. And I start by summarizing in just a nutshell to give an overview of the prophecy, but I quickly can go through these verses and unpack it for you.
Can you do it? Let's do that.
What happens is our loving God, who so loved the world, that sent his only begotten Son, that whoever believed in him will not perish but have everlasting life. He has foreign policy in place in Genesis 12, verses 2 and 3. Mm-hmm. And what it says is if how you treat Abraham and his descendants is how you'll be treated. If you bless them, you'll be blessed. If you curse them, you'll be cursed. That foreign policy written 4,000 years ago is still effectually intact. It is in play right now. So we have this whole bunch of enemies of Israel over there that want to curse Israel. So what Jeremiah said in 596 BC, that God is going to be fiercely angry at some point in time with Elam. And Elam, if we can get this up on the map, we'll show you a map of where Elam is on a modern-day map of Iran. There it is. You've got, as you see a modern-day map of Iran, you see that Persia comprises about 5/6 of Iran, and Elam comprises the other 1/6. And you see on there, there's a nuclear power plant there. I'm going to come back to that. That's the Bashar nuclear power reactor. It's a nuclear disaster waiting to happen. It is the crown jewel of Iran's nuclear program. We're going to come back to that in a minute. But something we're told in this prophecy is that God is fiercely angry with Iran. And so we find out why. He's going to destroy from there the kings and the princes. There's bad leadership, Perry. There's bad leadership. You don't destroy good leadership. He's going to destroy bad leadership. Why? They're wanting to launch something somewhere, we're told in the prophecy. They're going to want to launch something somewhere. Well, Iran today wants to launch something somewhere. Don't we know that? A big deal right now with Iran's nuclear program. So as I go through this, we find out that God's upset with them because they're trying to launch something somewhere. They're bad leadership. This did not happen during the time of Jeremiah or subsequently. Now, I will say this. Iran has had good leadership in the past, and it's important to recognize this. Jonathan brought it up with the Persian Empire. 539 BC, King Cyrus, who was mentioned by name in Isaiah 44 and Isaiah 45, was instrumental. He was called my shepherd, God's anointed. And when this prophecy was given to King Cyrus, after 70 years of captivity in Babylonian captivity, he was amazed, and the first thing he did was he fulfilled that prophecy. After 70 years, the Jews would go back into their land, and he sent them back, speaking of those cycles. But Iran has got bad leadership right now, and it says he's going to break the bow of Elam, hit them at the foremost of their might. Not only is he going to break the bow of Elam, he's going to hit them at the foremost of their might. He's going to prevent them from launching something somewhere. Now, Benjamin Netanyahu, the Prime Minister of Israel, is very concerned about two things. The ICBM, Intercontinental Ballistic Missile Program, in Iran right now. Matter of fact, he's warned that America could be hit on the East Coast in 2015 with a nuclear warhead, because that's what you put in an intercontinental ballistic missile. He's also worried about the manufacturing of uranium, because you can make a nuclear weapon. And Iran has vowed to wipe Israel off of the map. So it says that there's going to be the break the bow at the foremost of their might. And then it says, as this disaster happens, this judgment happens, that he's going to call the four winds from the four quarters of heaven, and he's going to scatter those outcasts of Elam, the Elamites, the indigenous population, into those winds. There'll be no nation where the exiles don't go. This sounds like a humanitarian crisis. We're not talking about what's going on with the modern-day example of the Syrian refugee camps and things with, you know, half of Syria has been displaced on some level. You got 2 or 3 million of them in refugee camps, but they had to get out into the neighboring areas. We're talking about a worldwide dispersion. What would necessitate that? Sounds like a nuclear scenario here.
Wow.
Okay. Then he goes on and says, Elam will be dismayed before their enemies and those that seek their lives. Does Iran have enemies today? Mm-hmm. Well, Israel's very concerned. The international community is trying to negotiate with the P5 plus one with Iran's nuclear program to get them to contain it. Israel wants it dismantled. What about the GCC, Gulf Cooperative States, across the Gulf over there that are very concerned about Iran's nuclear program? They're very concerned. By the way, the Persian Gulf over there, 2/3 of the world's desalinization plants are over there. And they, potable water and drinking water is extremely a rare commodity over there. There was an earthquake because this Bashar nuclear plant is built where three tectonic plates converge. There was an earthquake in 2013, 6.3 followed by a 7.1 near the border of Iran and Pakistan. And 37 people were killed, 850 people were injured, and that prompted the GCC states, which would be Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Bahrain, Oman, the UAE, to do an intense study about what's going on, what could happen if there was an earthquake or an Israeli strike on that nuclear facility. And they determined and issued a report in July of 2013 that 40 to 100% of their populations could be affected adversely in 15 hours, but only 10% of Iran's population could be affected because you have the Zagros Mountains right there that blocks that could in a blow over. So they decided to build a 1,242-mile pipeline at the cost of $10.5 billion to be completed by 2020, not for oil, Perry, but for drinking water to get through there because they're so concerned about Iran's nuclear thing. It goes on to say that because I'm fiercely angered, the Lord speaking, I will bring a disaster in Elam. We're talking about a disaster. Are we talking about a nuclear disaster? Are we talking about a humanitarian crisis that results from this? Yeah. And that's the bad news for Iran. I mean, and that will affect the world because they've threatened to shut down the Strait of Hormuz. They threaten terror throughout the world and our interests and things like that. There's two more verses that I'd like to come back as we close because that's the good news for Iran.
Let me say this to or ask a question here, and that is that, no one can really answer this, but like the administration is extremely friendly toward Iran, releasing billions of dollars to them and even trying to get them permission to keep their centrifuges and things. Does anybody here want to maybe express, and we can't really give an opinion because nobody knows, why with the warnings that Mr. Netanyahu gives, Mossad agents know, our intelligence knows, the danger of empowering the regime that's in charge there now, and they're a wonderful Persian people, by the way, here in the United States. Some of my closest friends are Iranian Persians, okay? And they're very, very... they remember the Shah. When the Shah of Iran was in, it was a great nation. It was a prosperous nation. Then the revolution happened in 79, changed everything, and the fanatics took over. We don't want to get into politics here. That's not why we're here. We're not politicians, and we don't get into politics. But does anyone have an idea? Do you think it's possible that just as in Romans 11, Israel, God allowed the veil to come over their eyes to allow the Gentiles in? Is there just a veil over leadership that the Lord is just going to fulfill his purposes using Israel, using the nations, and America's just going to kind of be back there? I mean, can anybody want to kind of go there for just a minute? Because a lot of people, I get questions about this all the time for emails. So do we have an opinion? Is it a blindness that's coming on the Gentiles or coming on this great nation? Maybe.
I think the Bible says sin causes blindness. And so if we are... you know, right now, driving God out of our lives, God out of our culture, God in all these ways, we can't do that without having some kind of blindness. It happened with the leaders of ancient Israel. They made big mistakes, and they often would engage when they didn't have the defense anymore. They didn't realize it, and God did this. God caused disaster. So, you know, one of the things that I've seen with the Harbingers is that people do things, say things, leaders say things without realizing what they're doing. There's, you know, we have several leaders who actually pronounced judgment on America. I mean, several of them, without realizing what they were doing. So, yeah, you can, you know, God is going to have his way in the end, and you cannot mock him. So, yeah, I believe that is an absolute dynamic.
In other words, the rejection of God creates a blindness to where you're saying to someone, why would we give a terror nation power? And it's like, why not?
Yeah.
We can negotiate. You know, can you imagine David showing up to Goliath and saying, I'd like to make a peace treaty with you? I mean, the Philistines are killing everybody. You can't negotiate with a fanatical regime.
Right.
You can't negotiate with ISIS. Someone said on television, if we could just give ISIS jobs, they'd quit doing what they're doing.
Yeah. It's unemployment.
You know, they don't want jobs because they go in and rob a whole bank and take everything out, and they've got... oil on the black market. They don't need jobs. And so it's difficult. But do you have an opinion? Is it a blindness? I mean, what, Mark, kind of comment, because a lot of people are asking this.
Right. Well, in Isaiah, and I think it's 25, it may not be, but God says he's going to remove the veil that is over all nations. So there's a veil over all nations. Uh-huh. And as we know, we see through a glass darkly. That's what it says. We only know in part. But the thing we have to realize is it also says in Proverbs that the king's heart is in the Lord's hands, and he turns it where he will.
Yeah.
And here we have American elections coming up. You know, they're getting ready for the Israeli elections.
Right.
And so, God, I believe at the end of this Shemitah year, the 2016, the first of the next following year, which is when much of the judgment falls, is the first year of the new cycle, God is putting
his person in Israel. He's going to be putting his person in the United States. And I believe what our position should be is the big difference between Abraham and Lot. Abraham knew what was coming, knew judgment was coming. He was up on the mountain with God, and he was interceding, whereas Lot, who was righteous, represents the church that is asleep, that is clueless, doesn't know what's going on. And in the ancient Hebrew language, Lot's name, the first letter was the Lamed, which was a shepherd's staff representing authority. Then you have the Vav, which is like a nail that connects. And then the last letter of his name was the Tet, which is a serpent. So Lot was one who gave his authority over to the serpent. That's right. What his name represents. And it's the church asleep. An amazing thing about tying this to Purim as well in the book of Esther. When it says that Haman goes to the king and says, there are a people who are scattered abroad. In Hebrew, that same phrase, a people scattered, could be also translated as a nation asleep. There's a nation that's asleep. And I believe in a large sense, America is asleep. And I believe that Israel is asleep and they need to come back to God, both Israel and America.
As a minister and someone who's in the prophetic, I'm in total agreement with both of you. We didn't have time to get to Bill over here, but we will come back in just a moment. But I believe that if we were to sum up that little section, it is that there is blinders and veils, and when people do not really know the Bible, what knowledge do you have to go on? And when they don't learn from history, what knowledge do you have to go on? And so I think it's a combination of things that we're seeing even in our own nation, that people are accepting things in the body of Christ that we never dreamed they would accept. I don't mean this to sound crude, but my granddad would roll over in his grave if he saw some church folks today, because they're just not praying, they're not fasting, they're not attending church half the time. And so we have an issue, but God, I believe, is raising up people. We just had a meeting here and saw over 500 people baptized in the Holy Spirit on a weekend. And so that's where I'm excited. We see a lot of young people. We're having youth conferences with 5,000 and 6,000 young people show up, and hundreds getting the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So America, listen, there's still hope. And there's still hope because God has got promises for us. But we've got to lay hold of them. We've got to go after them. Okay, we're going to take a praise break here. Javen is going to sing Worshiper in Me, and we'll be right back. Don't you go anywhere. We've still got a lot more to come. Thank you.
Let's worship the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. Oh, we love you, Jesus. It's a simple song. I want you to sing with me. It says, I live, breathe you, God. It says, I live to give you glory.
I live
to give you glory.
To give you glory.
And with everything I have, I'm here finally.
I'm here finally.
And I'm calling for. Somebody just wave your hand. Say, the worshiper in me. The worshiper in me. Come on, let's worship the Lord. Do I have any worshipers in the house tonight? Let's sing together. Say, I live. Come on, and breathe you, God.
Breathe you, God.
That's it. Say, I live to give you glory.
I live to give you glory.
And with everything I have, I'm here finally. And I'm calling for. Somebody put your hands on your chest. Say, the worshiper in me. Say with me, the worshiper in me. Hallelujah. Let's sing the verse together. It says, Lord, you are,
Lord, you are
my strong tower.
My strong tower.
My help.
My help.
And my strength.
I desire.
I want to know your ways.
To know.
fight, and I'm calling for. I need some worshipers tonight. Say the worshiper in me.
Worshiper in me.
All over the studio right now, just begin to lift your hands and just begin to worship the Lord. Some of you might want to say hallelujah. Somebody might want to say glory. Somebody might want to say thank you, Jesus. Wherever you are today, you might be in the hospital. You might be in the jailhouse. You might be somewhere on the streets. But just begin to lift up the name of Jesus. Because the more you begin to bless him, you'll begin to feel his presence. And when God's presence shows up, things have to change. Chains have to be broken. And just begin to open up your heart and say this. Freely.
Freely
I give you. Say all of me,
all me.
Come on, say I give you my worship.
I give you my worship.
My worship.
My worship.
You got it? Say with me. Say freely.
Freely.
Freely I give you. All of me. Somebody lift your hands. Say I give you my worship.
I give you my worship.
My worship.
My worship.
Come on, lift it up. Say freely. Say freely,
freely,
free I give you,
give
you my heart, my soul, my mind, give you my worship, Jesus,
I give you
my worship,
I'll
say with everything I have, that means you can have my present, you can have my past, you can have my future, say with everything, if you can use anything, Lord, I'm here finally, I'm calling for. Oh, we're calling for the worshiper in me.
The worshiper in me.
So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am, Jesus. Yes, there's a worshiper. Come on, clap your hands if there's a worshiper in you tonight. Oh, we love you, Jesus. Oh, we bless you, Jesus. Hey. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Wonderful. Let me make mention before we get started into this next session that all of our speakers have websites. They have books, DVDs that are available. We encourage you to go to their website and check out the material. We've written a brand new book with Bill Cloud. I know that Jonathan Kahn has books. Mark, all of us have material that we think will be a blessing to you. I just wanted to add that while we had a moment here. Let's go back to Jonathan. Now, Jonathan, we talked earlier about the Shemitah and the seventh year. Can you go back, because we didn't want to give everybody everything up front. Mm-hmm. We have to have a doubleheader. This is doubleheader night. Go back to what we call the Jubilee Shemitah, yeah. 7 times 7.
Yes.
And is there something we see developing with that? Mm.
Yeah, every seventh Shemitah, as we said, or every 49th year, ushers in what's called the Jubilee. And again, it's like a mega Shemitah. And it says they'll be released, but also it says that everyone shall return to their family's possession, to their father's house. If you lost your possession on the Jubilee year, you return home. You return to get that ancestral possession back. So, the thing is this. Now, we know end time prophecy focuses on Israel, and they have to come back. Israel lost its ancestral position. Israel lost its land 2,000 years ago when the Romans came. Israel lost all those things. So, could the Shemitah and the Jubilee, which is first for Israel, could this actually give us the timing, prophetic timing, of end time events when these things, when the restorations have to happen? And the amazing thing is, yes.
Well, I'm surprised at that answer. Are you?
It wouldn't be good if I said no when I walked off.
I mean, hey, let's keep going.
Yeah,
go
so
on.
The thing is this. So here it is. So here's what we know. Now, we don't know exactly when the Jubilee was celebrated in the time of the Second Temple, so we can't be dogmatic. However, we do know when the Shemitah was. And here's the key. The Jubilee has to happen after a year of the Shemitah because it happens after the 49th year. That's a Shemitah.
Right.
So it's got to do that. So here, what happens now, one of the things about the Shemitah is also, I said, it determines the rising and falling of nations. It actually marks global cataclysms, like it marked World War I Shemitah, marked World War II Shemitah, marked all 9/11. All these things are marked by the Shemitah. Now, 1917, World War I, you have the Shemitah. Now it ends on September of 1917. So now we begin that year after period. Now, could that mark the exact time of the restoration, beginning restoration of Israel? Well, here's the thing. What happens in the autumn of 1917? This is the time parameter given. Britain is in the war to end all wars. It takes the Ottoman Empire. Now, for 2,000 years, the land of Israel has been in the hands of enemies of the Jewish people, and it's mostly been in Islamic hands. So what happens? The Ottoman Empire has Israel, collapses. The British Empire takes it, gives it to the Jewish people in the exact time period ordained by the mystery of the Jubilee and the Shemitah. In that time parameter, they issue the Balfour Declaration. The Jewish people now can come home to their family's possession, to their father's land. So that's the first thing. Now, what happens if we count seven Shemitahs to the next seven Shemitah? Could this mark this next great prophetic restoration? Well, here's where it brings us. It brings us to the date of the beginning of the period set in this mystery, comes to September 1966 to September 1967. Does anything prophetic happen in that time of restoration? You have Jerusalem. The Six-Day War happens in the exact time of the seventh Shemitah from the 1917. And not only that, Barry, so here again you have return to your father's possession. Return. Jerusalem is the possession of the Jewish people. Yeah. So here you have Israeli soldiers for the first time in 2,000 years marching, coming to the Temple Mount. And what do you do at a Jubilee? The first thing you do is you sound the shofar. What's the first thing they do at the Temple Mount? They sound the shofar. And the one who does it is Shlomo Goren, the rabbi, most famous sounding of the shofar. Well, Shlomo Goren, the rabbi who sounded it, he was born in the year 1917, the other Jubilee. Yes. It was his 50th year. He was the Jubilee, and he sounds
That's
the Jubilee.
Amazing. That's amazing.
So you got all this happening at the exact time period. Now, what happens? Now, I'm not saying that God has to do it, as we say throughout this whole time, but we need to be aware. What happens if it continued? What is the next seventh Shemitah? The next seventh Shemitah is the year 2015. Now the period,
I'm gonna pass out right here. Y'all just take the program. Y'all just, I'm gonna lay down on the floor and just say, hey, Jesus.
Now the period after, or the period that it marks, would begin in September 2015 to September 2016. In that period, now, not saying anything has happened. However, if it followed the cycle and the pattern, this is what would happen. What the other things were with this. Every time it's happened, it has meant war in the Middle East.
Yes.
It has meant war concerning Israel, specifically, yes. Major war. It was World War I. Yep. It was the Six-Day War.
Yep.
And it resulted in a prophetic restoration.
For
Israel. Prophetic restoration for Israel. Now, the other thing about it is, if, again, we're not getting dogmatic, I put dates in the book, but that's not the point. But the point is this. When does the Jubilee begin? Well, the Jubilee begins September 23rd of 2015. Now, the interesting thing here, the Jubilee begins on Yom Kippur, always.
Yes.
So I'm going to throw out a thing, just there. Isaac Newton, okay? Isaac Newton, the man who came up with all gravity and all these things, the law. People don't realize, he came up with all calculations about Messiah's coming. Yes. People don't realize that.
Yeah.
And what he did, and the interesting thing is, people who took it, I'm not saying we're going by it, just interesting, but people who took it and calculated it out, calculated by that, based on this whole period, they came up with a date, came up with a year. They came up with 2015 into 16, and they came up with the date September 23rd, the same exact date of the Jubilee. Of that, Now I'm not saying anything.
They came up with this before Israel was ever a nation. So,
yeah,
so they weren't basing it on 1917, 1948 cycles. Sir Isaac Newton, most people don't know, wrote so more about the Bible almost than he did on science.
Yeah, yeah.
And Israel has his papers, or used to have his papers, of prophecy.
Yeah.
So that's what he's talking about here,
based on the book of Daniel. Based on Daniel, as we said before.
Yes,
So again, we're not saying it has to, but be aware, and this kind of goes with everything we've said here. You know, we're talking about destabilization, we're talking about things in Israel, we're talking about all these things are to ultimately bring about God's purposes. Each one, even war and destruction, brought about the restoration of the land, the restoration of Jerusalem, and so we know more is coming. He will come back only when my people come back to the land, come back to Jerusalem, and say, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. It's happening.
He's
people are coming back to the Lord.
He's speaking in tongues, he's speaking Hebrew,
that's a different thing.
I'm sitting here like, this is really, you know, I'm a guy that has 100,000 hours of Bible study, but I love hearing things that I've never caught. Isn't it amazing? You'll never quit learning as long as you live. Now, I can tell you're getting a little antsy over here, like you're ready to preach. Yeah. So, you want to carry on to something he said or pick up on something he said?
I sure would. Because, like he was saying, the year of Jubilee, all the land returns to the original owner. Okay? And what do we know? We know that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And it says in Leviticus 25, the land will not be sold forever because it's mine. It's coming back to me. And so we know, and a lot of people believe, the Lord will be returning in a year of Jubilee. You cannot keep the Shemitah year unless all the tribes are in the land, which is why the Lord gathers the elect from the four winds. The whole purpose is so you can keep the year of Jubilee. And so I really see that with the earth being the Lord's and the fullness thereof, it's his gathering of the elect, which could be this fall.
The ultimate thing, I mean, the kingdom is the Jubilee. I mean, the ultimate thing is he restores everything. We all return home. It's all about those things.
Now, Bill, do you want to add this, or do you want me to go ahead with Jonathan to show a picture that he wants to show? Let me say something briefly about it.
Along the lines of the restoration you're talking about, remember in 1967, they almost tripled their size by taking over the Sinai, the Golan, East Jerusalem, West Bank, etc., and where the Gaza is. In Genesis 15:18, God promised Abraham a lot of land. We call it the Promised Land, and that goes from the river of Egypt, probably the Nile, all the way to the river Euphrates, which courses through Iraq and Syria. At no time in Israel's history have they possessed all that land. Joshua possessed quite a bit of it about 3,300 years ago, and then David, even a little more, David and Solomon about 3,000 years ago. Now we have Israel back in the land, and they are growing, even though the international community wants them to trade land for peace. Isn't that funny how they've expanded territorially, but the international community wants to deprive them of that land and choke them in? But they're going to get all that land, certainly when Messiah returns, and we're told he's going to return and have a 1,000-year kingdom in Revelation 20, verse 4. But I believe that we need to be watching for other prophecies that talk about them getting some more of that land incrementally. When they win a war, and I believe they're going to win the Psalm 83, Arab-Israeli, concluding Arab-Israeli war, we find out in Jeremiah 49, verses 1 through 6, there'll be an alarm of war in Rabbah of the Ammonites, which is the capital of Jordan, in Amman, Jordan. It says it'll be a desolate mound. Remember, Amman, Jordan is not too far from Damascus. Sounds like almost a similar connection here. And it says that Israel will take possession of its inheritance. They could literally move in and take part of Jordan over. That is in that promised land. Remember, when they win a war, they take land. They feel justified in doing that, and it increases the defensibility of their borders. So I just wanted to add that if we end up in a war scenario, I would not be surprised to see some incremental land grab, because that is in prophecy as well.
Now, Jonathan, you keep teasing me about a picture. All right? Now, we got a little bit of time here.
Yeah.
Do you want to get into this?
Yeah, I can. Yeah, I can. I'll give
you
a little
bit. I bet you can. All right. Hallelujah. He's going to get into it here.
Well, first of all, I want to make sure we say this. Okay. One of the things is, in the last beginning of the Shemitah, there were foreshadows at the beginning which foreshadowed what would happen at the end. And not saying again, has to, but here's the thing. Interesting things. Were there anything that happened at the beginning? At the beginning of the Shemitah, which was in this fall, began. Interesting thing. First of all, a few things happened. On the day of the Shemitah, an earthquake struck America. Over 6 on the Richter scale. On that day, you spoke about Ebola. Interesting. The first manifestations of Ebola happened on the day of the Shemitah, the first day, also as well. Yeah, the day of the week of that Shemitah, Wall Street was destabilized for a month, just went crazy. Mm-hmm. Also, within 1 week of that Shemitah beginning, now the word Shemitah can mean fall, it could also marks the changing of power in the world, World War I, World War II, so it could mean fall. Well, within 1 week, Russia became the strongest super nuclear power in the world. That happened within 1 week. Within 2 weeks of the Shemitah, the age that began in 1871, I talk about in the book something called The Mystery of the Towers, and that it marks the beginning. Well, the American age begins 1871 because that's the year we become the strongest economic power on earth. And what happens is that age, 140 years, has come to an end. ended on the second week of the Shemitah. I've always warned of this, but America's crown is now, that crown is worn by China. That happened. It's massive. True. It is gigantic, and most people went by it. But here is a very, very kind of, I don't know how to explain this, but a biblical sign that happened, and most people didn't see it. Here's the thing. In the Bible, the first time there's an economic period, an economic cycle, it's actually the dream of Pharaoh, which is the 7 years, seven, Shemitah, again, 7 years of abundance, 7 years of famine, represented by the seven cows, seven fat cows, seven thin cows. Each cow represents a year. So, the seventh cow, or the cow number seven,
the Shemitah cow,
is the, hey, that's a new one.
Holy cow!
This is devolving.
I'm showing off, I'm sorry.
So
you're going to write a book called The Shemitah Cow next. I just have a feeling.
Yeah, well, it's coming, yeah. But the seventh cow would represent the seventh year, or the Shemitah year, right, and represents the change from abundance to famine, okay? Mm-hmm. So here's the thing. So here, cow number seven. Could God have given a sign as he did to Pharaoh back then to the nation about this, the cow number seven? Well, an image appears. It was carried in the fall, carried by the Associated Press all over America.
Oh, yeah.
And it was a cow that was born, and I want you to see the image. That is a...
Yeah. What? Yeah, it had the seven on it. Yes.
A cow.
That's an unretouched photo. That's unretouched. Actual.
That's true. That's
unretouched.
True.
That is a number seven on the cow's head.
Born with that number seven.
I am going to pass out. Y'all take the program. It's over. I'm on the floor. This is amazing.
Sign that was given to Egypt of the warning of the seventh year and the change from abundance to famine coming. Yes. But the other thing is, you know what day that came out? That came out on September 25th, the opening day of the Shemitah.
Yes.
All over America.
Yes, it did.
All right, is everybody in the, I can't speak to the folks at home because I can't see you. Is everybody in the audience totally blown away right now? Is this not amazing? This, and you know, as I'm sitting here listening to all of you gentlemen, this is the verse that keeps coming back to me, Daniel 12. Seal up the book till the time of the end, when many will run to and fro and knowledge will be increased. Yes. And it's not talking about business or secular,
right,
it's
exactly.
biblical. And exactly. folks, I'm telling you, I'll be... For those who may be interested, most of you wouldn't be. I'll be 56 years of age, and I've been in church all my life, fourth generation minister. I can tell you that never in my lifetime have I seen more understanding of biblical Hebraic mysteries than the past 24 months. It is incredible. And I really believe God. I asked my daddy one time, I said, Dad, why do you think maybe in your generation the deeper mysteries were not understood? And he said this to me, we were not educated people. And you had to preach simple to us. You had to preach basic to us. And he said, but now the people are very educated. They have degrees, master's degrees, PhDs, bachelor's. And so because the educational level is higher, God waited to reveal the mysteries of the Hebrew word studies, the Greek word studies, the Shemitah, whatever it might be, Harbinger, some of the things we have taught, the deciphering the end time prophetic code, a book we wrote that was, I showed you some of that. And all of those things that we're now seeing, because this generation became so rationally minded and so intellectually geared that they have to have more. And this is, here's the deal. The cycles, you can't deny them. And if you're an intellectual, you're a professor, you're someone that's into that type of thing, you have to listen to this and say to yourself, this cannot be a coincidence. See, we could sit here and preach scripture. John 14 says, Luke 3. If you don't believe the Bible, you're not going to believe what I'm preaching. But if you see these things from men who studied them, and I think everybody needs to be aware, God is opening up the prophetic word to this generation that think about this. Guys, we are blessed to be alive right now. Come on, give the Lord a praise. You at home, we are blessed to be alive right now.
Harry, let me ask you something. Did you say you're 56 this year?
Yeah, I'll be June 23rd this year.
You'll be 56?
Yes.
8 times 7 is 56. You were born in a Shemitah year. This
right,
is the Shemitah cycle.
I'm done. Bye.
Were you born in 1958? Or 59? Shemitah.
Yeah,
what time? What time?
June 23rd, 10 o'clock in the morning.
Real? Okay.
No. Okay, it's going to get freaky here in a minute. We're getting into something.
I found out only in studying this that I was born also in the same Shemitah year.
What year?
1959.
You were born in 59?
Yeah. And I entered the covenant. I was circumcised on Elul 29, the wipeout day, and the sun was darkened.
What?
There was an eclipse.
Yeah. What?
It's getting pretty personal.
I don't know. I guess I'm supposed to be doing it. We're supposed to be doing it.
I have no clue when I was circumcised. Okay, so
no, good. I'm not going there. You don't remember.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. 8 times 7.
That is so.
8 Shemitah cycles.
All right, I'm about to go. I'm about to go into spiritual trance right here, man. Bill. Ooh. I don't know when you were circumcised, but I want to ask you though. This, guys, really, we're having fun, but I'm telling you something. This is astonishing.
Yeah.
This whole deal, the cow born with the number 7. Are you kidding me?
The first day.
And here's what I've got to ask folks.
That was my birthday.
Yeah, I've got to ask folks that's watching at home. How many more signs do you need? Really? I mean, it's all the stuff's happening. And if you still don't believe, the Lord will help you. Because this stuff is going to. Now, Bill, you're. Yeah, I know you got a word over there, brother.
I'm not going to get that personal.
I don't blame you.
Otherwise, we'll cut him off.
Yeah. Go ahead. I know you got it. We were talking about the harvest a minute ago, too, of what
God is
doing that we can't miss. With all the stuff that we know, the warnings that God is giving and possibilities of wars, there's also the side that God is about to do on the revival. There is an end-time revival that's happening now, really, and it's going to intensify.
Yeah, that's the bigger backstory of this whole Elam prophecy. You know, we talked about the nuclear showdown in Iran, but there's also a spiritual showdown going on in Iran between Islam and Christianity.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, Iran has become the number one growing evangelical population in the world, growing at a rate of 19.6% per year, according to World Report, which most missionary-minded churches have that book in their library. Compare that to America, a little dismal 0.08% per year in that same report. We need more spiritual growth here in this country, folks. Get out and tell people about Jesus. That's what we need to do. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord, Psalm 150. But we're talking about a situation where there's dreams, miracles, healings, visions. One of the signs to me that we're so deep into the end time is that the Lord is pouring out His Spirit. He's rolling up His sleeves, Barry. He is taking it upon Himself to accomplish what His will is that none would perish. He will go from the ends of the east as far as to the west to reach out and bring anybody who would accept Jesus Christ into the family of God, and He's doing it through miraculous things. Most of these common conversions from Islam are they've had a dream or they've had a vision, and I know you've taught on this many times as well.
Do you have some stories? Do you have some things that you've heard about that people are seeing, like Jesus in a vision or a dream, or things are happening? Are you starting to hear this in the Middle East? It's happening.
Oh, absolutely. It's very, very widespread. I'll tell you one story that's very touching. It's called Padina's story. Matter of fact, you can get this on YouTube. Padina was a devout Muslim gal, and that's not her real name. She was a devout Muslim gal. She prayed 5 times a day, and she was not finding any hope in Islam. See, the Islam in Iran has gotten to a point where it's very disenchanting for them over there. Remember the Ayatollahs took over in 1979. I want to just give this brief prefaces on this. And they immediately entered into an 8-year war with Iraq, and most of the population in Iran is under 35, so many of them weren't even born before the mullahs took over in 1979. Well, Padina's story is this, that she was so disenchanted, and she was going to commit suicide. And that suicide is the number 2 death rate in Iran right now. Matter of fact, let me just say this too for your listeners. Christianity is growing so fast in Iran that the Ayatollah issued a decree a couple years ago to stop it, to close all home churches, to imprison all pastors and persecute all Christians. Well, Padina, she was so disenchanted, she was going to commit suicide, and she had an issue because her mother had multiple sclerosis who she was taking care of. And when she told her mother that she was going to commit suicide, her mother said, well,
then you're going to have to take me with you on this because I can't be left alone here. And so they were actually going to commit suicide. And a gentleman named Hormoz Shariat, who Joel Rosenberg calls the Billy Graham of Iran, he reaches into Iran through satellite television. I've been on the show many times. And he was on the show, and he said, if someone out there is going to commit suicide, please call me right now. Please call me. So the mother picked up the phone and called. And he talked to her, and she starts crying, and he's convincing her, talking to her about Jesus. And she's saying to Padina, pick up the phone, pick up the phone. You need to talk to this guy. And she was very, very reluctant. But she finally picked up the phone, and Hormoz talked to her for about an hour, Perry. She was so hard, he couldn't change her mind. And so he said, look, if you're going to commit suicide, you can do it in a week. Give Jesus a week. Just give him a week.
Wow.
Okay, see what he can do for you. And so she said, okay, I'll tell you what. I'll give Jesus a week, and then I will come back in 1 week, and I will go on your television show, and I will commit suicide with my mother and I in front of all your audience so that I can at least glorify Allah in my death.
Wow.
That was the situation. That's what.
Wow.
So she woke up the next morning to hear the sound of her mother's footsteps scuffling through the house, walking. She was healed. Padina, Jesus didn't need a week. Jesus didn't need a week. He did it real quick. So Padina said, this can't be happening. She took her mother into their doctor. And the doctor looked at him and says, this is a miracle. Your mother is healed 100%. What imam were you praying to? And Padina said, this can't be happening. This can't be happening. No, it's healed. What imam was she praying to? Were you praying to? And she said, we were praying to Isa. They call him Jesus, yeah. Isa in those countries. We were praying to Jesus. Jesus healed them. They are now serving the Lord. Matter of fact, Padina came over here and worked for Hormoz Shariat. She married a gentleman who he had discipled, who's in charge of about 4,000 Christians over there in the underground church. I've spoken with him many times. He's told me about the curriculum that they've got going over there. But here's the backstory on this, too, with Padina. And this is going to be touching to you Americans here, you Christians here in America. She worked with Hormoz. She was answering the phone calls and things like that. And she finally went to Hormoz and said, you know, Hormoz, I need to go back to Iran. You've been so wonderful for me. You've had me over here and this and that, but I need to go back to Iran. And he said, well, why do you need to go back to Iran? It's dangerous. You're probably going to get thrown in jail, and who knows what can happen. And she goes, because I believe Satan's singing lullabies to the church over here, and where it's really happening over there is where my people are, and they need me over there to disciple them.
Over here. Wow. Mm. Folks, I just want to say, too, that there are... We haven't touched on ISIS or that part of the world tonight much, but we need to be in prayer globally. All the Christians in the world need to be in prayer, and we need to put pressure, whether you're watching in the UK or you're watching in Australia or the United States, we need to put pressure on our leaders to help the Christians in Syria and Iraq and Lebanon right now, and to somehow to help them and stand with them. Many of them are losing their homes. They're just literally getting out with the clothes on their back. And if we don't, these are our brothers and sisters. It's not about are they Catholic, are they Orthodox, are they Baptist. Let me tell you something. If your name is in the book of life, you happen to be my brother and sister, no matter what name you go under. And so I want to encourage, I have a great love for the Arab people in the Middle East. Arab people are the most hospitable people in the world. And a lot of times I see the Arab Christians who get caught in the middle of the Middle East crisis. They're actually caught in the middle. If they have Jewish friends, some of the folks don't like it. And it's just tough on them. So let's really be in prayer for the men and women and the believers all across the world who are really suffering and being persecuted right now. And if it requires, I'll say this just from my perspective, if it requires intervention of military people to remove people who are cutting people's heads off, beheading people, then let there be a military intervention to stop this. Because I do know this. I do know in the book of Revelation, chapter 20 and verse 4, the kingdom of the Antichrist beheads people. It specifically said, I saw the souls that were beheaded. In Revelation 6, it even mentions martyrs who are in a special location of heaven. It's a special part of heaven, a special paradise. And they actually wait there until a general resurrection of the martyrs takes place. And so we know it's going to happen. But I refuse to allow a premature spirit of the Antichrist to take control. When it's not the time, and I'm going to tell you, Satan likes to try to move prematurely. He tries to say, okay, I'm going to raise it up now. But as long as we are prayer people and we have authority and we can do something, we need to be the restraining force that says we're not going to put up with this, we're going to stop it. And so let's be in prayer really for all of our brothers and sisters. And I want to call the church maybe to this entire week of just calling out in Egypt, Libya, Assyria, Iraq, Persia, all these countries for our precious brothers and sisters. And you know, let me say quickly, there is a great move of God among the younger generation in all these countries. It's underground. It's not made public, but it is absolutely fabulous. Now, Javen's coming to sing. Now, we're going to be back in a moment, so we still have some time left. Don't go anywhere, okay? He's going to be singing You Are My God. Give him a great big hand clap for the ministry of music.
Oh, we worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, we love you, Lord. We bless your name. We bless your name. Your grace sufficient for my soul. Your love has never let me go. I would be nothing without you. The greatest thing I've done is give my life to you. So I lift my hands. So I lift my hands. With my soul I'll sing. With my soul I'll sing. You are my God.
You are my God, King of kings, Emmanuel. No one is greater than you, Alpha Omega. You're the same, my guiding light. I give my heart, give my soul to you.
Give it all. Let's worship him. Oh, we love you. We love you, Jesus. Glorify you, Lord. Yes. Say, all I am.
All I am.
I present.
I present to you.
Yes.
Give my trust. You've always brought me through.
Submit my life.
Submit my life to you. Humbly I bow, completely to your will. So I worship you.
Say with me, yes, I worship you.
Yes, I worship you.
You are my God.
You are my God.
King of kings.
King of kings.
Emmanuel.
Emmanuel.
No one.
No one is greater. Than you,
Alpha
Omega,
you're the same,
my God in
life,
never change,
I give my heart,
my soul,
to you. Say with me, say glory and honor, say with me,
glory and honor,
you have all power. Somebody wave your hand. Say, holy.
Holy.
If you know he's holy, say, holy.
Holy.
Yes, you are my God.
You are my God.
Come on, all over the studio. Let's worship the Lord today. Let's give him glory. Let's lift him up. Wherever you are today, begin to lift up the name of Jesus. Just call his name. Healing will take place. Call his name. Deliverance will take place. Just begin to lift him up. We love you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We magnify you, Lord. Do I have any worshipers in the house tonight? Come on, let's sing together.
You are my God,
King of kings,
Emmanuel,
my everything.
soul to you. We give our hearts to you, yes.
All over the building tonight, just give him everything. That's what worship is about. It's about giving your heart to the Lord. It's about giving him the everything, your past, your present, your ups and your downs. I give him my heart, my soul, my mind. I give him my family, my future. You can have it all. I give you everything, everything, everything. Tonight we give it all to you, Jesus. We give it all to you, everything to you. Clap your hands one more time if you're going to give him everything tonight. We love you, Jesus. Come on, you can do better than that. Give him glory. Hallelujah.
Before we wrap up and do a little closing here, Jevin has a lot of music available. I mentioned earlier our speakers' websites. Go on this week, look up their material and get it. It's going to be wonderful. There's some of Jevin's great music, by the way. You can tell that just the presence of God, the anointing he carries. I've known him for quite some time. In fact, I used to listen to him sing when I was a baby in a crib. Come on, just being rocked by mama. We're going to wrap this up. Stay with us, Jonathan. About 2 minutes each. Let's go with the summary here.
Yeah, I want to kind of sum it up by saying, we are to sound the trumpet. I believe God is calling that and to wake up. And I will say it again. I believe a very great shaking's coming. Whether it happens in the Shemitah or beyond, it's coming. And I believe we need to be prepared. And people say, well, how can I be prepared or how can I be safe? And I want to give one Hebrew word above all, and that is the word for safety in Hebrew is Yeshua. And Yeshua is Jesus. He's our safety. Outside of him, there's no safety. Inside of him, there's no fear. So if you are watching this and you're not in Yeshua, get into Yeshua, get into Jesus, get your life into him. And if you are in him, the time is late. And what God is saying is that if there's anything in your life that has to get out, get it out. If there's anything in your life that doesn't belong, now is the time. Don't say tomorrow. Now is the time. You see, the Lord is having his way, and we need to be ready. And so if there, you know, the thing is that God is calling us to be greater. That's the point. If there, you see, there's hope. You know, people ask, is there hope? Well, the answer is there's always hope. As long as there's God, there's hope. And so people say, is there going to be revival or judgment? I believe there can be both. In fact, I believe that God causes shaking so he can bring revival. And I believe, in fact, without that shaking, it might not come. And so that God is calling us now to come out of this to be lights. If the dark is getting darker, the lights have to get brighter. If the bad's getting worse, we have to become great. So it says, the eyes of the Lord are searching the entire earth, even tonight, looking for the one whose heart is completely his. You be that one. You do what you have to do. You rule in the will of God. You do whatever it has to be, and you become that person, and God will lift you up, and God will make his light shine. Amen. Amen.
And I want to say that that those who are watching, if you're away from God or you've never had experience with God, there'll be a number on the screen. This is very important. You call that number right now before this program ends and let somebody pray with you. Please do that. Mark, what do you feel?
Sure. I just want to mention, as I write about in my book on Blood Moons, I have just two quick points. Number one is we have to be aware of God's cycles, God's timetable, God's day timer. And the other thing that we have to be aware of, I want to close with this part of it, is the story of Ruth is actually a prophecy. If you remember, Ruth and Orpah were these two non-Jews who married into Israel, grafted into Israel. So Ruth and Orpah represent the Gentile church who are grafted into Israel. Ruth's name in Hebrew means friend. She befriended Israel, worked the harvest, and ends up bringing forth the Messiah through King David. Orpah means to turn your back on, the back of the neck. Orpah turned her back and went back to her pagan gods, it says. So I believe in these last days, what's going to happen, there's going to be a dividing line within the body of Messiah, the church, those that turn their back on Israel and will join the one world church and go to their pagan gods, those that join the Israel, work the harvest, and bring in the Messiah. And so historically, they say Orpah beget Goliath, Ruth begets David, and this final cosmic battle, in one sense, is going to be between the, in the within the church, those that are David, those that are Goliath in the one world church. And so you need to be finding out from your church, does your church support Israel?
Yeah. Okay, Bill, what do you say?
Yes. Well, one of my favorite passages of all time is Ephesians 2:8 through 10. It says, by grace we are saved through faith. It's a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. But it goes on to say, for we are the workmanship of God in Christ Jesus, created for good works, things prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. You're not watching this by coincidence tonight. God has prepared things beforehand that this panel here is reaching out to you and telling you things are about to get very real. We're told in Isaiah 46, verses 9 and 10, that he is God, there is no other. He is God, there is none like him, declaring the end from the beginning. He authenticates his sovereignty to us all by knowing the prophecies that are coming to us. And why does God give us prophecy? He's not a God that has too much time on his hands. He's a God that holds all time in his hands. He's not trying to impress us. He's trying to inform us. And why? Because he loves us. And if God loves you that much, that he'd want you to know what's coming, to protect you, your natural response should be to turn your affections and worship him. Yes. This is the time now. This is the day of your salvation. And that's my message, Perry. Amen. Take it from there.
Amen. For those of you... for those of you who are watching, whether it be Canada, North America, or actually, TBN goes into 249 nations of the world. If you live outside, let's say, of the West, and you live in maybe a third world country, or perhaps you're watching on a laptop right now, or maybe even maybe an Islamic country, or a Hindu country, a Buddhist country, different religions of the world, I want to encourage you to do something. I want you to encourage you to say, God, if Jesus is real, let him visit me. Not doesn't matter what religion you are, because a lot of people say, is this thing really real? Is this Christianity thing true? Is it just another religion? Is this Yeshua, that's his Hebrew name, is he really real? I want to say something. I believe that no matter where you're watching, if you have a sincere heart and you really mean it and you're really wanting the truth and you were to ask God to let the Lord visit you, that you'll either have a dream or you'll have a vision or you'll have someone that out of the clear blue that'll just come up to you and really begin to share with you the things of God. There's a hunger in the younger generation. God said, I'll pour out my spirit on sons and daughters in the last days. You know, we're having conferences with 2,000, 3,000, 6,000 young people show up in Cleveland, Tennessee at OCI. And I'm seeing this already begin to happen where God is doing unbelievable things. It's incredible things with this generation. And I believe that despite everything we see, there's hope. There is a Joel 2 revival that coincides with the blood moons, yes, the solar eclipses, yes, and even the blood, fire, and pillars of smoke, which really are volcanic eruptions that come in line with the blood moon cycles, and that's happening now. Yes. So my point is that don't get so caught up just on the bad news that you see. Call on the Lord and understand we're about to experience the greatest days for the body of Christ before the coming of the Lord, yes, that there has ever been. There's going to be some warnings. There's going to be some tough times. But can I say this? For us who believe, it's going to be the greatest time. We're going to be in God's presence. We're going to have the joy of the Lord. We're going to be winning souls. And if you're one of those individuals, and I'll say it again, that's been away from the Lord and you've drifted and you've listened to this, it means one thing. The kingdom of God is coming. The kingdom of God will literally be set up on this earth with Jesus Christ. And you will either be in it or you won't. And if you're not sure where you stand, TBN has people that can pray for you on the telephone. I want you to call the number and let them pray. Now, I always want to take a moment to thank Matt, Lori, and also Jan, and honor Paul, who's gone to be with the Lord, a dear friend. And just say, Paul Crouch, if you're looking down, thank you for building the TBN network. My. It's carrying on. And Jan, I'll be coming soon to Orlando and down in that area to see the place there. So hope I get to see you, Jan. Love you. God bless you. Let's give the Lord a praise.
We're so glad you've been with us. Well, praise the Lord. TBN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today. Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TBN, P.O. Box 768, Station B, Ottawa, Ontario, K1P 5P8. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call our prayer partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. Now, until next time, remember to praise the Lord. We'll be right back.
This program has been brought to you through the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout North America and the world.
You were never meant to carry the burdens you bear. You no longer have to live with guilt or shame. God is waiting for you, and He wants to set you free. Christ came to give you an abundant life. At the Holy Land Experience in Orlando, Florida, the power of God is transforming lives. Healings, baptisms of the Holy Spirit, salvations, and forgiveness are happening in record numbers. So come, receive your miracle. God is waiting for you.